بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Hadith number 3 from the famous book Al-Arba'in al-Nawawiyya was narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab May Allah be pleased with them The Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم said Islam has been built on 5 pillars, testifying that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah and that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, establishing the salah, that is prayer, paying the zakat, making the hajj to the house, and fasting in Ramadan. And this was reported by al-Bukhari and Muslim. Simple hadith. Every single Muslim know this hadith by heart. This hadith is addressing the 5 pillars of Islam. And if you look at the eloquency of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, meaning that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam speaks few words that you need volumes to explain. Not because they're vague, but because they're so rich. And that is why it is sometimes impossible for us to translate a verse of the Quran or a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ into another language. Because Arabic is the richest language on earth. You can literally draw a picture by saying few words. However, the Prophet ﷺ said, Islam was built. And this shows you that the foundation of Islam are these 5 pillars. Without a pillar, the whole building would collapse. And that is why these 5 pillars of Islam, whoever denies one is a kafir, he's not a Muslim. Nowadays, if someone comes and says, fasting Ramadan is not a pillar of Islam, I don't believe that it exists, he becomes a kafir. Even if he prays, even if he gives zakat, even if he performs hajj every single year. Why? Because he rejected one of the 5 pillars of Islam. And what kind of Islam are we referring to? When the Prophet says that Islam was built on 5 pillars. Islam has 2 meanings. The first meaning is the total submission to the will of Allah, the Almighty. And with this definition, all previous religions fall under this umbrella, meaning that Adam was a Muslim, Noah, the first messenger of Allah, was a Muslim, Abraham, Isaac, Ishmael, Jacob, David, Solomon, Moses, Jesus, all messengers of Allah, they were all Muslims. That is why Allah the Almighty tells us, Inna ad-deena 'inda Allah Islam, that verily the religion accepted at the side of Allah is Islam. So Islam here means that the religion that encompasses, that includes the total submission to the will of Allah. So by this definition, the Jews who followed Moses were Muslim. And the Christians who followed Jesus were Muslim. Once they changed their religion, once they associated others with Allah, then they do not become Muslim because they're not submitting their wills to Allah. The second meaning of Islam is the religion of Islam. And this is what is intended by the hadith. When the Prophet says, Islam was built on 5 pillars, this is referring to the Islam. We know it as a religion that is followed by the Muslims worldwide. And these are the 5 pillars that have to be found with every single Muslim. As stated before, the 4 pillars, they're based and their acceptance is dependent on the first pillar, which is to believe that there's no God worthy of being worshipped except Allah. So this is the essence of Islam. No person could enter Islam without this testimony. And whoever believes in the testimony is rendered and he is labeled as a Muslim by default. So any Christian comes and says, I believe that there's no God but Allah Azza wa Jal. I believe that. I believe that Jesus is a messenger. He is not the son of God. And I also believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the prophet of Allah, is a messenger and a servant of Allah. If he testifies this, if he believes in this and he says it, he becomes a Muslim. So this is a prerequisite for anyone to become a Muslim. And in this hadith, we find that it is essential that you start with the most important and then you gradually go down bit by bit. So if you're making da'wah, if you're calling people to Islam, don't begin with asking sisters to wear the hijab. They're not Muslim yet. So the first thing, you go to a non-Muslim lady, you tell her, you have to cover yourself. This is not a priority. You don't go to a non-Muslim and say, the first thing you do in Islam is you grow your beard, or you do this, or you circumcise. The first thing in Islam, you have to circumcise. Why? This is not the proper way of doing it. Begin with the most important. As the Prophet said, alayhi salam, the pillars of Islam, one, the testimony. And that is why when the Prophet alayhi salam, sent Mu'ad ibn Jabal to Yemen to call them to Islam, he says, be careful. You are going to invite people of the scriptures to Islam. So the Prophet alayhi salam, first of all, knew the environment he was sending his messenger to. And this shows you that a da'i, a scholar, a ruler has to have common sense plus knowledge of the environment. Remember when the Prophet ﷺ allowed the Muslims in the first era of Mecca to migrate because they were being tortured and prosecuted? He allowed them to migrate to Abyssinia. What did he say? The Prophet said, go to Abyssinia, for the king of Abyssinia is a fair man and no one would be treated unjustly in his presence. How did the Prophet know this? Did he check CNN or BBC? No. They didn't have any newspapers, but they had news of the countries around them, and the Prophet was learned. So he knew who the people were and how they treated others. Likewise, when he sent Mu'ad, he told him that you will approach people of the scriptures. So let it be the first thing you call them to, not to stop wearing gold if they're men, or to grow their beads. No. The first thing you call them to is to believe in the existence of Allah and that there's no God worthy of being worshipped except Him. If they submit and they say, yes, we believe in that, then tell them afterwards, stage two, tell them that Allah Azza wa Jal mandated 5 obligatory prayers. If they submit and accept, tell them, stage three, that Allah Azza wa Jal has put a certain percentage on their wealth, on their deposits, to be given to the poor and taken from the rich. So this percentage, very negligible, taken from the rich and given to their own poor. Not for us, not for the Muslim state, it's for you. So you have to be gradual in your da'wah, and you have to start and begin with the most important. Likewise, if I come to a Muslim who's sinful, who does not pray, and I find that his fingernails are too long, it would be inappropriate and unwise to go and tell him, you have to clip your nails, akhi, this is wrong. The guy doesn't pray. I should talk to him about prayer and the importance of prayer and drag him to the masjid with me with my kind words. If I succeed, then I go to stage two. Now, what is the meaning of the testimony when we say to believe that there's no God worthy of being worshipped except Allah Azza wa Jal? This is something that you say, but you have to believe as well. And scholars say that there are 7 conditions to completely fulfill the testimony of La ilaha illallah. So they say that there is knowledge, certainty, acceptance, following and submission, truth, sincerity as well, and love. So when we say knowledge, you have to understand what this means. When we say certainty, knowledge is not enough. You have to be certain in your heart that there is no God worthy of being worshipped except Allah Azza wa Jal. When we say acceptance, so you have knowledge and you have certainty, but you don't have acceptance. You have the rulings coming to you from Allah or from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but accepting it is difficult. I love this and I love that, but Allah does not love it. So which do you choose? You have to follow. So even if you accept it, you have to follow physically what you're being commanded to do. And you have to be truthful. So you don't accept it, but in reality, you're not truthful in what you're saying. You're just simply pretending. You have to have sincerity. So whatever I do, it is solely for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. And I have to have this love and compassion when saying it and when stating it. These are the conditions of saying La ilaha illallah. But this is half of the testimony. And there's another half, which is also a very important half. This is the belief that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah and his servant. And what does this require? This is what we will learn after the break. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. So, أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. I bear witness that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his messenger and servant. What does this mean? Saying it is something and believing in it is another thing. So what are the requirements of my testimony and how important it is? First of all, it is half of the testimony that a person says to embrace Islam. Meaning, if you do not believe in it, you're not a Muslim. So if someone comes to me and says, Akhi, I believe that Allah Azza wa Jal is one. I believe in his existence. I believe of the seven conditions that you've mentioned. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I cannot say that he's a messenger of Allah. I believe that he's a truthful person. This person is a kafir. If you do not believe in the message of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, you're not a Muslim. So what does أشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله mean? Well, it means that you have to believe in what he had told us. You have to comply with his orders, stay away from his prohibitions, and not to worship Allah other than what he has taught us. These are four essential things. They illustrate the meaning of أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. You have to comply with his commands. And he was mentioned, صلى الله عليه وسلم, in the Quran, where Allah Azza wa Jalla says, whatever the Prophet Azza wa Sallam brings to us, we have to comply. And whatever he forbids us from doing, we have to refrain. If you do this, then this is part of your belief that the Prophet Azza wa Sallam is the messenger and servant of Allah. And we have to believe in whatever he had told us. So if he tells us that hell is like this and paradise is like that, if he tells us that after your death, two angels, horrific in appearance, they're horrific, they're terrifying, come to an individual and they harshly question him, we believe in this. If he tells us that there is a straight path that is as thin as a hair and as sharp as a blade, and we're instructed to pass, and this straight path is on top of hell. It's like a bridge, and we have to walk that bridge. We believe in that. So these are the three things. The fourth, not to worship Allah except by what he had taught us, meaning that we have to comply and follow his sunnah to the letter. You cannot innovate. You cannot bring something new and worship Allah the Almighty except through what the Prophet had taught us, alayhi salatu wasalam. So if someone innovates something, he says, listen, I'd like to invent a new feast, a new celebration, a new Eid, and let's call it the Eid of this and that, Valentine Day. And we get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal by worshiping Allah on Valentine Day, for example. This is an innovation. It's not accepted, and it goes against the testimony وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ. I bear witness that Muhammad is his messenger and servant, صلى الله عليه وسلم. So you do not innovate. You just follow. You comply. This is the first testimony, which is the most important, without which a person would not be considered to be a Muslim. The second pillar of Islam is prayer. And the importance of prayer is that the companions of the Prophet ﷺ did not consider anyone as a kafir for leaving some forms of worship except to the person who abandons prayer. And the Prophet stated this clearly in black and white when he said that the treaty between us and them, us Muslims and them non-Muslims, is Salat. And the Prophet also said in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, between man and shirk or kufr is abandoning prayer. Between man and reaching the stage of shirk or kufr is abandoning prayer. And Allah Azza wa Jal stated this in the Quran in so many places. The consensus among scholars, whoever, they say, whoever denies prayer and he says, no, it's not important, it's not a pillar, he's a kafir. And they differ over those who do not pray entirely, though they believe in its existence. The pillar of prayer is the most important after the testimony. So it is the most important pillar after the testimony. Then we come to zakat. And zakat is a negligible percentage taken out not from the rich or the poor, but taken out from anyone who possesses a certain amount of money for a whole year. And it should be paid for gold, silver, and banknotes, money. It should be paid for crops coming from the ground. And the detail you will find in Umdat al-Ahkam, as we've discussed this before. And it is taken from things prepared to be sold and bought for merchandise. And finally, on the cattle, camels, cows, and sheep. And it has its rulings. Then in the hadith, the Prophet said, pilgrimage. And here, the Prophet mentioned it as the fourth pillar, but the majority of the other hadiths, it is the fifth. So it could have been said in one incident, and in another incident, it could have the rank 4 or 5. There's no problem in that. So performing pilgrimage is part of the pillars of Islam. With the grace of Allah, it's one journey in a lifetime. One journey. If you want to add more, alhamdulillah. If you don't, then this is up to you. Hajj is both physical and financial, because I have to put money into it and I have to go physically. So it has one of the highest grades of getting closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. And it's a journey that requires 4 to 5 days. But the reward is unimaginable. The Prophet tells us, alayhi wasalam, whoever does this, and that is going for Hajj without slandering or fighting or arguing, he does a perfect Hajj, he comes back from his Hajj as the day he was born. No sins, clean records. And finally, the Prophet is mentioning to us fasting. And fasting is, as you know, to refrain from the things that nullifies fasting from the break of dawn till sunset with the intention of getting closer to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And it's 1 month every year, and that is the month of Ramadan. So you refrain from these things that nullify your fasting, such as food, drinking, sexual intercourse, intentionally vomiting, or those who have obstacles that prevent them from fasting, such as women in their menses or in their postnatal bleeding. Of course, these things that break your fast, you have to have 3 conditions for them to break your fast. You have to eat or drink knowledgeably. So if you're ignorant that this particular thing nullifies your fasting, this doesn't affect your fasting. You have to be remembering, which means that if you eat and you forgot that you're fasting, your fasting is valid, it's intact. And you have to be choosing, meaning that if someone puts a gun to your head and tells you to eat while fasting and you eat, your fasting is intact because you're not choosing, you were forced to do this. Now, these five pillars of Islam, some people consider it to be difficult. Are they difficult? And the answer is no, they're not difficult. They are in harmony with our personal lives, with our ability. Allah does not burden us, the Almighty, with things that we cannot do. Allah does not order us to fly or to walk on the water. He tells us to do the things that are within our ability, and we are certain and sure that these things are for our own good. And this is the summary of Islam. Wherever you look and wherever you look in Islam, you will find that it fits your lifestyle. It fits where you are, and it benefits you beyond words. When Allah tells us that this is mandatory for you to do, we may feel a little bit burdened with it, but actually it's not. This is our devils and Satan's whispering in our ears. Look at prayer. How many are there? Five prayers a day, divided on the length of the day and night. The benefits? It gets you closer to Allah. It gets you connected to Allah Azza wa Jal. Look at other religions where they do not pray at all. Look at giving zakat. People worldwide are getting richer and richer, and the poor are getting poorer and poorer. In Islam, it's not like this. If you're a multimillionaire, you have to give 2.5% of your possessions once a year. 2.5 is nothing. You have 97.5 remaining with you. So the 2.5, if every rich person in Islam gave his zakat, his purdue, as a pillar of Islam to the poor, we would not have any poor. But unfortunately, they're not complying. Look at fasting, Ramadan. 30 days or 29 days, depending on the month, where you cleanse your system. When you strengthen your willpower by making halal things, permissible things, food and drink, you make them prohibited for you for a portion of the day, almost half of the day, maybe a little bit longer. This trains you. This gives you the willpower to stay away from forbidden things. And it cleanses your system from being attracted and attached to worldly matters. And finally, pilgrimage. When millions, literally millions of Muslims, wear the same dress code, you cannot tell who's a beggar and who's a king. And they go and perform the same rituals, only wanting Allah's pleasure. 4 or 5 days, you meet other Muslims from all over the world, you share the same rituals, you go to the same places, you remember that this is the same thing that would happen on the Day of Judgment when people are resurrected and gathered for being accountable. It's the day of reckoning. It's a reminder, but it is a powerful one that draws you closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. These are the pillars of Islam. This was the third hadith of Al-Arba'in Al-Nawawiyyah. Until we meet you next time, fi amanillah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Allahu Allah.